Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week in Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories in science. Once again, there is talk of a nuclear confrontation in the Korean Peninsula. But this time, intelligence agencies claim that the North Koreans may have up to 60 atomic bombs, not to mention the fact that they have mastered the art, apparently, of miniaturizing a nuclear warhead capable of perhaps reaching the U.S. of A., at least the West Coast. And this, of course, has ratcheted up all the war talk rhetoric between the United States and North Korea, with President Donald Trump saying that a nuclear war would be met with fire and fury, the likes of which the world has never seen before. And the question is the rhetoric spiraling out of control? Are we going to be on a collision course with North Korea with unforeseen consequences, or is it too late to begin negotiations? So we'll talk about that in today's Exploration. Also, eclipse mania is sweeping the country. Did you realize that hotels are pretty much booked solid along this corridor between Oregon and South Carolina, where the eclipse will roam across the continental U.S. of A. on August 21st? In fact, I'll be there myself. On August 21st, I'm going to be speaking in Missouri at the Southeast Missouri State University, right smack in the middle of this total eclipse. Some people call it the eclipse of the century, and we'll say a few things about that. And also, speaking about the sun, did you realize there are a lot of mysteries still yet to be revealed about the sun? First of all, comparing it to black holes. Scientists recently have redone the experiment done on an eclipse in 1919 with Albert Einstein's theory of relativity, this time with a black hole. And guess what? Einstein comes out right once again. And then we'll say a few things about what is not known about the sun. For example, what causes the gigantic coronal mass discharges, which, if one of them were to hit the United States, God forbid, from the sun, it would cause havoc. Our satellites would be blinded. Power plants would go down. There'd be massive food riots all over North America because all electronics would go down. The internet would go down. Commerce would come to a grinding halt. All because we don't know that much about the sun. And so we'll say a few things about that on Exploration. Well, let's just jump right into some of the top stories of the past week. Our lead story today concerns a report from U.S. intelligence claiming two startling developments: that the North Koreans may be much more advanced in their nuclear arsenal development than previously thought. The North Koreans, in fact, may have up to 60 atomic bombs, mainly made out of plutonium from their Yongbyon nuclear facilities. But of course, we don't know for sure, but that's an educated guess. Another educated guess is that the North Koreans have now solved the problem of miniaturizing a warhead so it could be placed on the nose cone of a missile. Now, in order to hypothetically strike the United States with a preemptive nuclear strike from North Korea, you have to have at least three elements down pat. First of all, you have to miniaturize the warhead so it could fit on top of an ICBM. Second, you have to have the ICBM capable of reaching the United States from the Korean Peninsula. And third, you have to guarantee that the warhead will strike. You have to make sure that reentry will be negotiated successfully and that the warhead will accurately drop on its intended target. So on that scale, where are we with regards to these latest developments? Well, first of all, the big development last week was the fact that the North Koreans launched not one, but two ICBMs, the latest of which could theoretically hit the west coast of the United States. So apparently the North Koreans are mastering that capability of launching a warhead from Korea to hit the United States, continental United States. And the new development is that U.S. intelligence agencies are saying that they may have mastered the art of miniaturizing the warhead. In fact, there's one controversial photograph of Kim Jong-un standing next to a compact sphere about the size of a large basketball that some people claim could be a miniaturized atomic bomb. We don't know for sure. But the weak spot in all of this is none of the above. The weak spot on all of this is the reentry. There are indications that the payload disintegrated on reentry. So in other words, it may take a few more years before the North Koreans get it all together. That is a miniaturized warhead sitting on top of an ICBM that could reach the US of A from North Korea and then landing intact on its correct location. It may take a few more years before the North Koreans get everything in place, but it means that, well, perhaps by the end of the decade, there's going to be a tremendous amount of pressure on President Donald Trump to negotiate or launch a preemptive strike. And speaking about Donald Trump, his latest pronouncement is that the North Koreans will be met with fire and fury, the likes of which the world has never seen before, if the situation spirals out of control. Donald Trump mentioned the fact that he's open to negotiations, but he's prepared to go to war if the talks break down. And specifically, he has drawn an unofficial red line. He has not stated so precisely, but many officials interpret his statements to mean that there is a red line. And that is, if North Korea has the ability to actually reliably strike the United States with an ICBM, that's the red line. That's cause for war. And speaking about war, President Donald Trump said that, well, a war in Asia is tolerable, but not a war in the United States. In other words, he's the president of the United States, not the president of Asia. His first priority is to make sure that the people of the United States are shielded from the havoc of war, meaning that the North Koreans will under no circumstance be given the capability of launching a reliable preemptive first strike on the United States. Well, North Korea, not to be outdone, has ratcheted up the rhetoric as well, this time claiming that, in case it goes to war, they're fully prepared to take out the military installation in Guam. In fact, the North Koreans were very specific. The North Koreans said that they are willing to fire four intermediate-range non-nuclear ballistic missiles in the direction of Guam, hitting the area around Guam to within a radius of about 20 to 30 miles. So in other words, it's not an act of war, but it's very close, as the North Koreans for the first time threaten to launch ballistic missiles in the direction of Guam to within 20 miles, four intermediate-range ballistic missiles. Well, then the question is, well, why Guam? Many people are scratching their heads, but first of all, you have to realize that that's where the B-1 bomber is stationed. And if there is an airstrike on North Korea, from where will it be launched? And that is Guam. And that's the reason why the North Koreans singled out Guam. Well, in order to disentangle this mess, you have to look at it from three different perspectives, from the U.S. perspective, the North Korean perspective, and the Chinese perspective. From the U.S. perspective, well, there's a maniac in North Korea. He's unstable. He wants to use nuclear weapons to blackmail the United States. However, from the U.S. point of view, the military options are horrible because Seoul, the capital of South Korea, is very close to the demilitarized zone where there are literally thousands of artillery batteries that can launch a strike on the South Korean capital and basically level it within a matter of hours to days. In fact, many wargamers assume that it would take about 3 days or so in order to wipe out all of the artillery batteries that the North Koreans have assembled. But within one day, they may be able to inflict intolerable casualties on the people of South Korea. Not to mention the fact that if North Korea has up to 60 atomic bombs, and even one atomic bomb were to escape a preemptive strike, that one atomic bomb may land in Tokyo or may land in South Korea. So in other words, we're talking about casualties perhaps in the hundreds of thousands if a first strike is not reliable. Now, of course, that doesn't stop the press from speculating about what a first strike would look like. One scenario laid out by NBC News was the following, and that is perhaps President Donald Trump could launch a preemptive non-nuclear surgical strike, not aimed at the nuclear weapons stockpile of North Korea, but the ICBM military bases. In other words, it would be a disabling strike, but it would not be a mortal strike. And it would allow the North Koreans to then reconsider the options afterwards. Does it want to escalate and go to full-blown war, which would mean, of course, suicide on the part of North Koreans, or would it begin to negotiate? Well, of course, this is all hypothetical. It turns out that, yes, military exercises from Guam show that it would be possible for a preemptive non-nuclear strike to take out the ICBM sites so that the North Koreans would no longer pose a direct threat to the continental United States. However, all of this is on paper. When I was in the military years ago, they told me one thing that every GI has to learn, and that is the concept of the fog of war. That is, no matter how careful your plans are laid out, no matter how many times you rehearsed everything, something is going to go wrong because of lack of communications, because of the unpredictability of enemy actions, because of defections and problems within your own forces. All hell could break loose because of unforeseen developments. So yes, on paper, it looks as if a non-nuclear surgical strike may be possible, but who knows? Who knows what the response of the North Koreans would be at that point? Would they assume, therefore, that this is the sign of an all-out nuclear war, the final conflict between socialism and capitalism? Or would the North Koreans say, okay, the other option is suicide, so let's go to the negotiating table? Well, now look at it from the North Korean point of view. From the North Korean point of view, they say, well, it's the United States that's the aggressor. I mean, after all, who has all these nuclear weapons? They do. Who has the overwhelming firepower? They have all the firepower. And the atomic bomb is, in some sense, a guarantee of survival. The North Koreans aren't stupid. They saw what happened to Saddam Hussein. They saw what happened to Gaddafi. Both of them are no longer with us. In part, they conclude, because they didn't have nuclear weapons. So the North Koreans see the atomic bomb as the ultimate safety blanket. That is, it's the guarantee that they will survive no matter what happens, because they can inflict intolerable damage on the United States, so much so that the United States will not launch a preemptive strike. Well, that's the North Korean point of view. However, you have to look at the game changer in this whole process. The key to this whole puzzle may be China, because China has the ear of both Donald Trump as well as Kim Jong-un. China holds all the cards because China is basically providing the lifeline for the very survival of the North Korean regime. Look at it from the Chinese point of view. The Chinese want to keep the North Korean regime intact, because if it were to collapse, perhaps hundreds of thousands or millions of starving people would flood into China, creating a huge mess. And if it goes to war and the government of North Korea were to collapse, it means that, well, who would take over North Korea? Obviously, South Korea. I mean, look what happened to Germany, after all. And if South Korea takes over North Korea, then what happens to U.S. military forces? They could conceivably be placed right on the doorstep of China. So in other words, there's one thing they fear more than the destabilization of North Korea. The thing they fear most is, quite frankly, the United States. And that is, they don't want the United States military on their doorstep. Well, who has the key to this whole crisis? And who has, in some sense, the most to lose? It's actually China. China holds the cards because they can talk directly to Kim Jong-un. They have the lifeline that keeps the North Korean regime alive. Plus, I mean, guess where many of U.S. goods are manufactured? In China. China is a huge trading partner of the United States, not to mention the holder of much of United States debt. The U.S. debt, in terms of U.S. treasury bonds, much of it is controlled by China. So China has the most to lose if it spirals out of control. However, China has its own problems. First of all, it has a brewing border conflict with India that easily could spiral out of control, especially when both India and China have nuclear weapons. Not to mention the fact that the Communist Party, every 5 years, has a huge Congress in which it begins to choose the leadership for the next 5 years. And so China is in some sense preoccupied with this transition. And the Chinese leadership, unfortunately, have their attention turned toward that Congress rather than focusing on the emerging crisis in North Korea. So in other words, China holds the cards. It has the ability to shut down North Korea with just one turn of a spigot. It has the ability to get the air Donald Trump. But unfortunately, the response of China has been disappointing. Instead of taking a leadership role, China simply says that it wants to stay clear of all this rhetoric and simply says that people should tone down all these pronouncements of war and terror and fire and fury, however, without proposing a comprehensive solution of its own. Now, what is the worst case and the best case scenario? The worst case scenario is it could go to war. Tens of thousands will die perhaps within the opening shots of the war. Eventually, hundreds of thousands to, who knows, millions of people could die if atomic bombs are used in Asia. And of course, it means the annihilation of the North Korean regime. However, look at the best case scenario. I mean, back in the 1970s, it looked as if the United States and China were to go to war because China was amassing a small nuclear stockpile. And I still remember articles saying that the time is coming, the day of reckoning, that the United States will have to take out Red China. Well, what happened, of course, is in the history books. Nixon went to China. We had the hardliners in China led by Mao and the hardliners in the United States led by Nixon. And guess what? Nixon went to China and defused the crisis and, in fact, changed world history as a consequence. Now, some people think that maybe, in a best-case scenario, a grand bargain could be reached to permanently denuclearize the Korean Peninsula, to somehow guarantee the survival of the North Korean regime, which is what it wants, and a comprehensive peace pact would end the Korean War going back to the 1950s. Now, of course, that's just a dream, and more than likely, that dream will not be realized, but there is a best-case scenario out of this. And the best case scenario is that a grand compromise be made, that what the United States wants is a denuclearization of the entire area, and what the North Koreans want is a guarantee of survival. So who knows? We can only cross our fingers now at this point. Also in the news, eclipse mania is gripping the United States. That's right, 99 years ago, back in 1918, we had the last full total eclipse which crossed the continental U.S. of A. And on August 21st, many people are saying we're going to see the eclipse of the century. Now, let's be clear about this. First of all, a total eclipse of the sun takes place every 18 months somewhere on the planet Earth. However, you have to wait about 100 years or so before you have this perfect storm. That is a total eclipse that cuts right across the U.S. of A. It turns out that in 2024 and 2045, we will again have a total eclipse of the sun that reaches the USA, but not with the precision of this total eclipse. The total eclipse will start around 9 o'clock in the morning, Eastern Time, starting in Oregon, will sweep across the United States, and leave South Carolina about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, again, Eastern Standard Time. Well, of course, scientists say that, well, there's nothing new under the sun because, of course, we know a lot about the sun and about total eclipses. However, some people are using this opportunity in order to investigate the sun itself and Einstein's theory of general relativity. It turns out that back in 1919, there was another total eclipse of the sun that allowed physicists to test Einstein's theory of gravity. Einstein said that even light must bend under gravity, and he calculated exactly how much light would bend under the influence of the sun. So you would have to take a picture of the sky with the sun and a picture of the sky without the sun. Sounds simple, right? However, the problem is, how do you take a picture of the sky in the presence of the sun? Well, you can't, because starlight is dwarfed by sunlight. However, during a total eclipse of the sun, that's when you can see very briefly for about 2 or 3 minutes the background stars. And that meant that, yes, indeed, you could take a picture of the sky with the sun and an identical picture of the sky without the sun and compare the two. Well, the calculation was done in 1919 with two expeditions, and bingo, Einstein was right. Well, now scientists want to redo that famous eclipse experiment, this time with black holes. That's right. In other words, the gravitational field of the sun was rather small. And what about testing Einstein's theory against the distortion of space-time due to a black hole? Well, this is what scientists are doing even as we speak. It turns out that at the center of the Milky Way galaxy, there is a raging black hole. It weighs roughly 2 to 4 million times the mass of the sun. And yes, we can actually calculate the orbits of stars as they whip around this black hole. The preliminary calculations show that, well, bingo, Einstein is right once again. It turns out that even in the presence of a gigantic gravitational field, the gravitational field of 4 million suns, that light bends just the way Einstein predicted, and the orbits of stars are distorted just the way Einstein predicted. You see, back in 1919 or so, many astronomers believed in a planet called Vulcan, which was never found. It turns out that the orbit of Mercury deviates slightly from Newton's laws of motion. Now, scientists were horrified because we believed in the laws of Isaac Newton. Either Newton was wrong, or there must be a new unseen planet out there tugging on the orbit of Mercury, perturbing it. Well, astronomers looked for Vulcan and found nothing. But then here comes this unknown physicist called Albert Einstein, who says that, no, I can show that, in some sense, Newton was wrong. And Einstein could calculate the precise deviation of Mercury's orbit from Newton's laws of motion, and bingo, once again, Einstein came out right. Well, that's the calculation now being done with a black hole at the center of the Milky Way galaxy. It turns out that the orbits of stars very close to the center of the Milky Way galaxy, near this gigantic black hole, are distorted just the way Einstein predicted. So once again, Einstein got it right. However, another scientific reason for looking at this eclipse is as follows. It turns out that we have a mystery concerning the sun. It turns out that the corona, that is the atmosphere of the sun, is actually much hotter than the surface of the sun, and that violates common sense. Common sense says that the farther you are from the sun, the cooler it should get. But no, it turns out the corona, the atmosphere of the sun, is much hotter than the sun itself. Why? Well, we don't know. But this also may help to explain the mystery of coronal mass discharges. You see, not only do we have the mystery of the atmosphere of the sun, but we also have the mystery of why the sun ejects from the sunspots gigantic balls of plasma called coronal mass discharges, which are sent into outer space like bullets. Most of the times, they miss the Earth. However, once upon a time, there was a direct hit back in 1859, which physicists even today are studying very carefully. It turns out that astronomer called Mr. Carrington was observing the sun back in 1859 and noticed a gigantic eruption on the surface of the sun, a coronal mass ejection. Sure enough, it turns out that several hours later, a gigantic disturbance took place in the atmosphere of the Earth. The disturbance was so great that it wiped out telegraph transmissions. Telegraph lines spontaneously sprung into action, even though they were inert, because of the extra electrical discharge coming from the sun. Well, physicists today can take that incident and calculate exactly how much radiation came from the sun. and the results are astonishing. The American Physical Society, physicists there had done the calculation, and they estimate that if it were to happen today, property damage would be about $2 trillion. That's trillion with a T, not a B. It would mean that satellites would be wiped out, communications would go dark, the internet would be disrupted, power plants would be short-circuited, there would be food riots because people's food would begin to spoil because refrigerators around the world would go on the blink. In other words, it would be a real mess. It would only take millions of dollars to correct it in order to reinforce our satellites, create redundant systems. But Congress, unfortunately, rejected the proposal of physicists, and they simply rolled their eyes into the heavens and said, "What? An attack from the sun? Give me a break." Well, these attacks do happen, and perhaps the eclipse of the sun will help to shed some light on the whole question of whether or not a monster flare from the sun could once again disrupt communications, power lines on the planet Earth. In other words, a massive coronal mass discharge could literally hurl civilization itself 100, 200 years back into the past before the electric age. Think about it. An electromagnetic pulse from the sun itself wiping out telecommunications, the economy. Everything depends upon electricity and telecommunications, and yet all of it could be wiped out from the sun. Now, you may say to yourself, has it happened before 1859? We're not sure. However, scientists have gone to ice cores, that is, going to Greenland, digging into the ice, and retrieving ice that was laid down centuries, thousands of years ago, looking for the telltale fingerprint of another coronal mass discharge, which create a slight chemical imbalance in the ice. And sure enough, it does appear as if you go back further enough into the past, there were other coronal mass discharges in Earth's history. However, you do have to go back a few hundred years. So in other words, we still have time. The last coronal mass discharge was back in 1859. Perhaps we're not due for another one in perhaps another 50 to 100 years, but that hopefully will give us enough time to prepare for the next big one.